how often do you tweak models and frameworks?
That is actually something that we're quite proud of. Quants, despite we like to say it is one item, we might, you know, call a model a particular purpose and objective, but at the end of the day, it's a constantly evolving life cycle. It's never done. Right. And this is why my afternoon is always interesting when I look through different projects. But I think to us, one of the key part is having a robust life cycle where, you know, you do the research and revisit it and re-underwrite it, look at the performance, and the cycle goes on.
Welcome back to Insights Now. I'm Gabriela Santos, Chief Market Strategist for the Americas here at JP Morgan Asset Management. This year, we've been spending time on Insights Now, sitting down with our research analysts across JP Morgan Asset Management, first in equities and then in fixed income. And for this season, we're chatting with multi-asset research analysts. They spend their time doing research on how tactical and strategic asset allocation should adapt to shifting macroeconomic and policy environments, different desired investment outcomes, such as retirement, and across different investing styles, including fundamental and quantitative investing. On this episode of Insights Now, I'll be joined by Grace Koo, co-head of Risk Managed and Total Return Portfolios in our Multi-Asset Solutions team. Among her many areas of focus, Grace spends a lot of time doing quantitative research and investing. I'll ask her to explain to us what quantitative investing is, how it can look like in practice, and what are some interesting trends she's seeing in that space. If you're listening to the audio version of this podcast, you can watch along on YouTube by tuning in to our JP Morgan Asset Management channel, which is linked in the show notes. Now, let's get started. Grace, welcome to Insights Now.
Thank you for having me, Gabby.
So excited to have you. And before we dive into the thematics, can you zoom out and explain exactly what quantitative investing is?
So quantitative investing, simplistically, is just a strategy that is systematic in nature, rule-based. And if you think about the world that we're in with all the technology and innovation that is coming in record speed, it is a very exciting space that we believe that can be adaptive and actually add alpha to our investment processes.
How would you say it's the most different from fundamental investing?
So I think fundamental investing is a good complement to quant investing, but there's always an element to the subjectivity. You might have a few that may be more macro-based. There might actually be a level of human judgment and intuition embedded in it. While for quant, it should be systematic. You clearly can have similar type of framework, but I think what is the biggest difference is going to be the fact that the human judgment is removed. And so you can actually capture biases, et cetera, better than otherwise.
And this isn't new. The quant investing is not new. How did it come about decades ago, and how has it changed since then in terms of different strategies?
Yeah, so the growth in the quant investing is definitely something that has been in there for decades. At the beginning, when computing power is clearly more expensive, it is something that's been more simplistic, but actually exists in the marketplace as well. If we think about things that are more top-down, more on, let's say, a asset class level, but then as time progresses, the computing power and our understanding of the market has grew as well. So you see more granular, single security type analysis start to pop into markets. There are also strategies that may be a different style. So think about there is trend strategy. There are strategies that have more intuition in how we formulate the quantitative models. But there are also strategies that are purely quantitative, like statistical in nature. And so you may not understand what it is, but there is actually an underlying core theme within the numbers. And it's like spotting patterns in the numbers. And so there's various style and has clearly been evolving together with the technology that we have as well and how to capture these trends.
A lot of different flavors since these were first created. In the 1970s, maybe?
Yeah, the 1970s, wow. Clearly when it started exploding very large.
Oh, wow. And how do these strategies work in terms of actually making money for investors?
Oh, that's a very, very good question. Everybody cares about, you know, how it's done.
Yes.
And so for our perspective, in some sense, you have to have an understanding of what you're trying to capture. So in our world, market is broadly efficient, but there are market inefficiencies in selective pockets. So the way that we'll find it is try to identify it via robust research and an understanding about how to get them. And these inefficiencies can come from different aspects. It can be from market microstructure, so how the market itself is actually defined and set up can create certain inefficiencies. It can be how information flows and how people digest information. It can also be behavioral, so a human-driven biases on how you interpret some of the items or how you react to information can all cause these kind of micro pockets of inefficiency. So our research will try to identify them and systematically capture them. And so we capture these market inefficiency and structural biases in our design.
That's super interesting. And in terms of how these different inefficiencies have evolved and the strategies to capture them, what are some recent strategies and trends that you're seeing pop up?
Yeah, so I'll give you two examples. One that we are quite core to our processes are systematic macro strategies. And one of the reasons why we do think this is the fundamental part of it and continue to be very important is the fact that we can have a good number of different bets. So you can think about relative value bets that can be small individually. They can be directional views that are also small individually. But then if you put the collection of them together, they become very, very powerful. And the way that we think about it is if you go back to your fundamental law of active management, how do we generate alpha? We make money and generate alpha by creating good insights, which clearly via research, we can develop that good insight, and via breadth. And I think this is where exactly quant is very, very powerful, is because we can have that breadth. Once a good piece of research is done, then it can be very scalable. And you can add more and more of that without actually creating incremental labor and stress within, you know, things that you need to do. And another one that we're actually currently very excited is on trend. Gabby, you know, as we work on the long-term carbon market assumptions, one of the key things that are quite clear within our forward-looking horizon is uncertainty. There's a good amount of uncertainty in the macro environment. And we do believe these trend strategies can help dynamically adapt to them very quickly. And so for us in a multi-asset solutions lens, finding strategies that can help navigate these particular challenging times beyond our classic diversifier like bonds, right? If you know, one of the things that we like to say between us about diversifying the diversifier, I think is clearly in play in these type of strategies as we look for things that help us quantitatively move into a space to mitigate downside risk or to help us actually change our allocation when the market conditions shift very quickly.
Yes, that's so interesting. And in those LTCMAs, all these trends that maybe weren't in place before, right? Inflation, uncertainty, volatility, fiscal rates. So I could see how that's really exciting about the strategies. And how do you incorporate all of these different types of quantitative strategies within a broader strategic and tactical asset allocation? How that your team does? I assume it's very complementary.
Yes, absolutely. So the way that we think about the quantitative strategy comes along, if one has a desire to have a pure quant strategy, they very powerfully can stand by itself and stand alone. But we are in actually a very excellent spot and very lucky to have a fantastic fundamental platform as well. So our core differentiator, I would say, is the fact that we actually have both. We have excellent quant and a fantastic fundamental team, and how we integrate them is how you're going to get the best of both worlds. And so a lot of our work and the way that we think about our tactical asset allocation or strategic asset allocation is about diversifying. It's about diversifying through our different alpha engines and also the environments that we're likely going to actually go into. So we build a lot of tools and actually try to capture capture them in the most robust way.
And for you, I'm always curious. You and I interact a lot on the long-term capital market assumptions and the volatility correlations portfolio implications piece. So I know there's some, I know a little bit some of the work you do. But besides that, what's a typical day like for you?
So my typical day, I will separate from like the first half of the day and the second half. So my morning tends to be very focused on portfolios. So I'll wear my portfolio management hat, clearly trying to understand, you know, any news that came overnight or any market changing things that we should actually reflect in a portfolio and how we would do it as well. Or if our quantitative signals updated overnight, where would they be? And make sure that we have an excellent capture on those insights in our actual portfolio. So that tend to be like my start of the day. So whenever when I'm done with those tasks, then it becomes the more interesting pieces and more freeform. In some sense, it becomes how we actually manage to create those insights, how we manage to actually set up those research, etc. So it can come into, let's say, talent management, working with other people, working with other researchers in creating those, let's say, it can be models, it can be frameworks, it can be how we think about interacting the engines that we talked about between quant and fundamental. So the second half is very freeform, but I think is the most interesting part.
And how often, actually you bring up an interesting point, how often do you tweak models and frameworks?
That is actually something that we're quite proud of. Quants, despite we like to say it is one item, we might, you know, call a model a particular purpose and objective, but at the end of the day, it's a constantly evolving life cycle. It's never done. Right. And this is why my afternoon is always interesting when I look through different projects. But I think to us, one of the key part is having a robust life cycle where, you know, you do the research and revisit it and re-underwrite it, look at the performance, and the cycle goes on. And in a time so exciting where there's so much new techniques and technology, I think our life cycle is even faster than before. Right? You can imagine there's a lot more data that we can look at. There's a lot more techniques we can look at. So that life cycle is clearly going through rapid changes. But that's where we keep, you know, finding new talents to help, you know, find these insights that builds into new strategy, but also existing strategy. A lot of things that we go through on, you know, we're talking about trend, we're talking about systematic macro, they might just become a more powerful version of them, right? They don't necessarily say, you know, they're going to be dinosaurs and they're going to die. But I think I would like to see it in a more positive light where they will just keep evolving. That you will just get a more powerful version with all the new technology and investments that we're putting in our research platform.
And it seems like you have to constantly evolve if it's about market inefficiencies.
Exactly.
You have to, right?
And so the cycle of change is going to be the most robust when the changes are the biggest, right? So let's be in a rates fixed income model when there's structural changes. Then clearly that's when, you know, it can become the top of, like, you know, out of the many different research projects one should take, you know, that one might just go pop in the top of the priority list.
Is that for you the priority now, fixed income?
That definitely is something of interest, given the fact that the rates cut cycle has started. But we also, as we discussed, quite conscious about that uncertainty in the forward-looking backdrop as well. So trying to make sure we take ample alpha opportunities, but also build a robustness in the portfolio. I think we want a strong balance to make sure that there's no unforeseen, you know, circumstances that will take us off trail.
And how did you get into this space, Grace, of quantitative investing, managing portfolios?
Yeah, so my personal journey is in some sense quite straight. I got quite interested in investment. So, you know, I hope you can tell, you know, it's something that I'm quite passionate about.
Very much. Yeah.
And so I already knew what I wanted to do. And I started off by balancing what do I think is going to be a good way of getting there. So I started off going to get a PhD. So I got my PhD in finance to get my hard skill. So I went to Kellogg School of Management, got that hard skill, and then decided, okay, now the hard skill, I need to actually figure out from the academia perspective, what is right and what's not right. So I jumped into the deep end, joined JP Morgan's investment banking side, and learn about markets, learn about how is it in practice, right? Mm-hmm. Not just in academia, how this market actually worked. Went through 2007 to 2009 in that role, so clearly learned a lot about, you know, how models can fail, how markets actually behave, what actually illiquidity means, and a lot of the very realistic market implication came to life. Have the fortune that that was fine, still have a job. Then decided to make actually all my learnings from academia and the markets in practice and move to asset management. And the journey starts.
And was it very different, the academia piece you had learned and then in practice?
Very, very different. I think the fundamental quantitative skills and your critical thinking is hard to beat when you get thrown into academia setup and you learn how to actually think very clearly on different aspects of, you know, let's say you're reviewing a paper, let's say you're reviewing a research work, or you're just having an intellectual debate. It gave you the clarity from how they kind of train you on your thought leadership. But they clearly don't have as strong as a few in terms of how financial market actually operates. Yeah. So you learn a lot on those on the job.
Absolutely. And for someone who did want to start reading or listening to this realm, what would you recommend as a book or a podcast or a movie or a journal? External, one internal.
So the ones that, one book that I quite like is called Expected Return. And so he basically wrote a book about investment strategies. And I found the strategies being something that is quite difficult to capture generally. And so that's something that I thought the book itself was excellent for someone that kind of wanted to learn, just because it covers the underlying concept quite well in a very layman way. At least I found the reading not very difficult. But once you have those, I actually do find reading journals quite interesting. And so I mean like academia journals. It might sound very funny, but I do actually think it's nice to keep track of what is out there currently. What is, like, you know, a non-practitioner looking at to pick up if there is an alternative way, just to kind of push the envelope a little bit.
Absolutely. And what about an internal piece that you
Internal pieces, I like to read more markets related items. And so I would even say I recommend people to read the long-term capital market assumptions because it pushes you in another area, right? Like, we don't model these long-term that well, but I think it does open your eyes in terms of other considerations that you might not actually naturally build into your short-term thinking. And so it creates different, let's say, risk or different elements that one should start to consider if you want your system or signals to run well in the long term. So I think that will be a not very quantitative article, but I think it helps kind of bring out other considerations that marries into your investment process.
Beyond the day-to-day of what you're already deep in the weeds of. Thank you so much, Grace. This has been so much fun. And thank you, everyone, for listening and watching. Make sure to look out for more Insights Now episodes right on this feed.
This material is for information purposes only. The views, opinions, and statements of financial market trends that are based on current market conditions are those of the speaker and may differ from those expressed J.P. Morgan Asset Management or by other areas of J.P. Morgan Chase & Co. Any companies referenced are shown for illustrative purposes only and are not intended as a recommendation. We believe the information provided here is reliable, but should not be assumed to be accurate or complete. The views and strategies described may not be suitable for all investors. This content is intended for information only based on assumptions and current market conditions and are subject to change. No warranty of accuracy is given. This content does not contain sufficient information to support investment decisions. It is not to be construed as research, legal, regulatory, tax, accounting, or investment advice. Investments involve risks. Investors should seek professional advice or make an independent evaluation before investing. The value of investments and the income from them may fluctuate, including loss of capital. Past performance and yield are not indicative of current or future results. Forecasts and estimates may or may not come to pass. J.P. Morgan Asset Management is the asset management business of J.P. Morgan Chase & Company and its affiliates worldwide.